Dr. Michael Hudson is a renowned economist. He's a Wall Street analyst. He's a professor, and he's an economic advisor to countries. He's also the author of Super Imperialism, The Economic Strategy of the American Empire. Recently, he's been outspoken on the global currency tensions, what some are calling a currency war. And this will be a key issue for world leaders at the G20 summit, which is coming up in South Korea. So we wanted to get his input. I want to thank you for joining us, Dr. Hudson. Now, we recently saw last month G20 leaders come to some kind of an agreement on not competitively devaluing their currencies, with details to come later at this G20 summit. But with no details and with no real way to enforce this, do you think it will be possible for them to reach a deal, and would it even matter?
There is no possibility of any agreement when the United States is declaring financial war on other countries. The United States is going to China and saying, we want you to commit economic suicide just like Japan did. We want you to follow the same thing. We want you to revalue your currency. We want you to squeeze your companies. We want you to go bankrupt so we can make a profit at your expense. We want you, the Chinese, to allow our banks to gamble on your currency and make a huge gain on foreign exchange speculation so that our banks can get out of the problem that we've got them into. Will you please help us by going bankrupt for our benefit? Well, you can imagine what the Chinese are saying. They're laughing. They're thinking, you know, are you guys joking? Countries don't work like that. So the American policy is not only to devalue the dollar, but to flood the global economy with money. And this means that other economies are facing an onslaught of American money coming in to buy their land, their buildings, their real estate, their companies, their currency, and essentially you have America's financial system and the banks acting as an army to raid foreign currencies. You don't have a deal unless you have penalties for breaking an agreement. If you don't have a penalty for breaking an agreement, there is no agreement. All there is yet another broken promise. That's unfortunately how the United States has been conducting diplomacy for the last 50 years. Deals are for other people to follow, not the United States. It puts itself over and above the agreements.
Okay. The G20 reached this deal, though, by giving more voting power to emerging nations. You know, clearly there's been this shift in the balance of power in the world that is starting to be reflected in global governing bodies.
Giving a country a voice in the IMF is like telling an ambassador, you can go to Times Square and you can get a microphone and you can yell to Times Square. It doesn't make any difference at all. The IMF philosophy is a very pro-US philosophy. Only the United States has veto power within the IMF. The philosophy of the IMF is that in order to increase the economic surplus, you have to reduce living standards and you have to essentially impose austerity.
What about the G20 then? Where does that fit in?
It doesn't have a body of theory that is based on economic austerity for the rest of the world and a free lunch for the United States.
US President Barack Obama will meet with Chinese leader Hu Jintao on the sideline of the summit. And one of the main issues the U.S. has been pressing for is for China to revalue its currency, saying that it's been undervaluing its currency to boost exports. Can the U.S. even make this argument?
The big fiction is that the United States' balance of payments is caused by trade. The deficit is caused by a capital outflow of money managers here putting their money abroad, and the military deficit. China says, look, we've been financing your budget deficit with our $2.5 trillion of foreign exchange. You're spending your budget deficit on military bases to ring us around, to take aggressive action against us, to put your spy planes where they bump into our spy planes, to interfere in our waters. You want us to pay for your military budget, to threaten us, to make us do what you want us to do? You must be crazy.
What leverage does the U.S. even have? It's the largest debtor nation in the world. China is the largest creditor nation in the world. The U.S. relies on China to finance its $14 trillion debt. How does President Obama have any leverage?
Well, that's the problem. Obama doesn't really have any leverage at all because he needs the favor from China and from other countries, from Brazil, from Russia from India of saying, please accept our IOUs, our paper dollars, even though we have no way of paying for it, and even though we can never pay off these debts, please accept them and let us buy out your real estate and your companies with dollars that we'll never repay. That's what he's asking for. There's not very much leverage in that position. And when you, the question is how you can wrap it in a nice way, and America can talk, let's talk about how we can have equilibrium, and other countries can say, but you're not in equilibrium yourself. You, America, are the cause of our disequilibrium. Why don't you do what you've told us to do? The IMF tells other countries, raise your interest rates if you have a deficit. Sell off your industry. Privatize it if you have a deficit. China is treating the U.S. dollar reserves it has like a hot potato. How do they get rid of them? They've wanted to do two things. First of all, they wanted to reciprocate and buy U.S. companies, just as the U.S. wanted to buy China. The U.S. says, we will not let you buy filling stations here or refineries. You can't buy in America. We can buy in you. You can't buy in America. You have foreign takeovers all the time of U.S. companies, but they're European takeovers, or they're takeovers by friendlies. So obviously, America views China as a potential enemy, which is what it is on the Pentagon's list of strategic enemies. So why should China finance America's military spending around it? That's what the dollars are worth, are being thrown off. America's throwing off these dollars in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Japan, in its bases around the world. That's what the deficit is, and that's what the U.S. isn't talking about. That's what they're talking about in China, because when I go to China and talk to the officials, that's what we talk about.
Is the U.S. hypocritical in its dealings with China when it doesn't even talk about quantitative easing while it's printing trillions of dollars?
The U.S. has benefited from what is in effect a double standard because of the dollar standard. The U.S. debt is other people's asset. When you spend more than you get, then other countries end up with the dollars. The United States is the only country which has run a balance of payments deficit and has not raised its interest rate, has not raised its taxes.
Now, this is something that you also dealt with in your book, Super Imperialism, that the U.S. has been able to get other countries to finance its debt, to essentially finance its wars, the 50% of its discretionary budget that is devoted to defense. How has the U.S. maintained this?
It happened largely by inertia. After World War II, the United States had most of the world's gold. And by 1950, the United States had 80% of the world's gold stock. So the dollar was as good as gold. Other countries began to accumulate dollars because until 1971, they could exchange them for gold. Once the United States stopped converting the dollars into gold, people really didn't have enough of a foreign currency to hold in their foreign reserve. There's no way in the world that America can ever pay the foreign government debt that it owes, because it's running a military deficit, a capital account deficit, and a trade deficit. So what is the point of any country holding more dollars in the central bank if it can never get paid? And there's a basic mathematical principle. A debt that can't be paid won't be. So other countries are trying to prevent getting more dollars, and they're trying to circumvent the dollar. That's why, in the last month, China has negotiated currency swaps with Turkey, India, Brazil, Malaysia, Russia. That's what the meetings in Yekaterinburg were last year in Russia, to make the BRIC countries with their associated countries, such as Iran and the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, operate without using the dollar. So the effect of quantitative easing by the Fed is to turn the dollar into a pariah currency that everybody's trying to avoid because nobody wants them. You can't use them to invest in the United States. Because of the nationalism here. Other countries don't want dollars. What is the point of accepting more dollars?
So then what is the future of the U.S. dollar as the reserve currency?
It means that it's finished. Other countries, and basically all the countries at the G20 meeting that are coming up in Korea, realize that the dollar's era is over. The question is, how do you bury it in a way that is polite? You want to do it slowly. You don't want to do it suddenly. But very politely, they'll tell the U.S., your time is over.
And what does this mean for the future of the U.S. as a global power?
It will slowly shrink, because how can it support its military bases abroad if nobody will accept its dollars? How can it import from other countries if people won't accept dollars in excess of what the United States earns? The United States won't be able to buy other bonds or invest in other countries abroad, because the countries will not let other Americans or other investors using dollars buy their domestic currency to pay for exports or to pay sellers of these companies. So essentially, the dollar will be a paper currency that can't be used. So the irony of this is that the Federal Reserve, in order to save banks that got into trouble by running crooked, dishonest operations, to save these banks, they're sacrificing America's position in the world.
And when does this all come to a head?
In Korea, G20 meetings.
I want to thank you so much for talking to us about this.
Well, it's been a real pleasure. Thank you very much for having me on your show.